Here, we'll look at the asynchronous methods that are available for communicating with the SQLite database. Reading and writing data into our database on the main thread is a synchronous I/O operation which stops our app from doing UI things. And if these I/O operations don't complete quickly, the UI thread is unable to respond to the user. And how do you think this impacts your users? What kind of ratings will your app get in the App Store? So our goal is to push our I/O onto a background thread, just like we would in a desktop app. However, a SQLite connection can only have one outstanding operation at a time. If you want to use a connection with multiple threads, you must guard the access with a lock. Now, SQLite connections are thread agile, so we can use it on any thread, but they are not thread safe. You can only have one outstanding operation running at any given time. Running two operations will very likely crash your app and possibly corrupt the database. And once the DB is corrupt, SQLite will throw a SQLite exception with the message corrupt anytime it's accessed. You'll need to delete it and recreate the database, and all of your data will be lost. Fortunately, SQLite.net includes an asynchronous API through the SQLite Async Connection class. Now, you can, of course, create your own threads to perform database tasks. However, there is a built-in async API. Let's take a look. We can create and remove tables with the createTableAsync and dropTableAsync methods. We can perform our CRUD operations with get, insert, update, and delete async. And the API includes methods to perform direct SQL queries. And we'll take a closer look at these in just a moment. Now, these are the most commonly used, but there are others as well, including methods which work with arrays of records. As an example, this method reads all data from the person table and adds it to the field people list. So to use the async APIs, we would add the async keyword to our method, and then any async method calls within the body are preceded with the await keyword. The keyword await will suspend any further code execution only within the method itself until a result is returned or the async operation is complete. Then execution within the method continues and we can process the results. And we should always return task or task of T for error reporting. We can use transactions to ensure updates across records are handled correctly. So for example, to insert, update, and delete a set of records together. We can use the run in transaction async method to execute a block of statements, passing in an action that accepts our SQLite connection, and using transactions ensures that this is ACID. And this means that the transaction is atomic, so all record inserts are successful or none of them are. It's consistent, so reads are always consistent until the transaction commits. This means if a record does not exist in one read, it still won't exist if we reissue that query. It's isolated, so changes made during the transaction are not seen until they are all complete and it's committed. And durable. If a failure occurs, the database will not be left in an inconsistent state. The transaction either completes or it fails and the database remains in its pre-transaction state. And the ORM mapping is great, and it's fairly easy to work with. But it also abstracts the SQL away from you. And as a result, it may stop us from pulling specific types of data out of the database, across tables, for example. And for these types of queries, you can use the lower-level methods to issue raw SQL statements to SQLite through our connection. We can use the execute async method. This performs a direct SQL query and returns the number of affected rows. We have execute scalar async, and this performs a direct SQL query and returns the single result. And we have query async, and this performs a direct SQL query again and turns it into an object map. Here's an example using execute scalar async. This is retrieving a max value from the database. And this type of query is harder to create using the ORM, and it's much easier to do directly. Now, coming back to the async and await keywords. Now, they greatly simplify working with tasks, especially when we want to process the results of an I/O operation on the UI thread. However, in some cases, the processing does not need to be done on that UI thread. We only need to be on the UI thread if we plan to update the UI in some way. If the data will be used for background processing, then it's inefficient to marshal back. And in these cases, you can use configure await false to tell .NET to not return control to the calling thread after the awaited call is finished. Instead, you will typically stay on that background thread.